Random House Audio presents In a Dog's Heart. This is the author, Jennifer Arnold. This book is dedicated to Neil and Margaret, now and always, and to my son Chase, who teaches me about dogs every day. Dogs have given us their absolute all. We are the center of their universe. We are the focus of their love and faith and trust. They serve us in return for scraps. It is without a doubt the best deal man has ever made. Roger Karras. Prologue. In Their Heart of Hearts. I'd first noticed the anxious mother when my dog Butch and I arrived at our departure gate at the massive Hartsfield-Jackson Atlanta International Airport. She was near the boarding area, jiggling a crying baby and holding the hand of a beautiful little girl who appeared to be about 3 years old. Looking at the sea of people crowded around the entrance to the jetway, I decided to give Butch a drink of water and a few treats before attempting to board the plane. After filling his bowl, I glanced back at the young mother. She was trying to get the busy gate agent's attention, undoubtedly to ask if she and her children could pre-board to get settled. But the crowd was blocking her from his view. The baby was now quiet, still in her mother's arms, but I could no longer see the little girl. Just at that moment, Butch pulled away from me, weaving through the sea of legs surrounding the boarding area. I scrambled along in his wake. When I finally caught up, I found him nuzzling the little girl who'd gone missing. The mom and I had reached the pair simultaneously. And upon seeing her mother, the child pitifully wailed, "Mommy, I got lost, but this saver dog came to help me." Then she wrapped her arms around Butch's neck and started crying. After a few deep sobs, she snuffled out a little giggle and said, "He has a really big head." As the mom watched Butch tenderly snuggle her little girl, a look of understanding came over her face. In that instant, she recognized the profound impact Butch was having on her daughter. In a very quiet and serious tone, she said, "I suspect this dog has an even bigger heart." She was absolutely correct. Butch has a huge heart. I was fortunate enough to tour for my first book, Through a Dog's Eyes, with Butch beside me every step of the way. He might be the kindest, most patient creature I've ever known. He graciously greeted hundreds of people, even though there were times when he was so tired he'd fall asleep standing up between greetings. Bigger than all of Texas is my Butch's heart. But then I suspect most dogs have big hearts. After the airport incident, I couldn't stop thinking about the heart of a dog. Not the actual heart that pumps blood, but the metaphoric heart, the very essence of the individual. I thought about the fact that my mom used to use the expression, "in my heart of hearts," when she wanted to convey her seriousness about a particular matter. I was amazed when at the very next book signing, a lovely older woman asked me, "What do you think dogs really want in their heart of hearts?" Before I could tell her I'd been thinking about that for days, her husband asked, "And why should I pay for it?" We all laughed, but the more I thought about it, the more I recognized these were valid questions. What do dogs want and need in their heart of hearts? And why does it behoove us to give it to them? My short answer to the woman's question is, dogs simply want to be happy. And they want us to be happy with them. My answer to her husband's question is, their value to our world far exceeds whatever they might cost us. Chapter 1. What Dogs Want. He's just a baby, the woman told me, but he seems so withdrawn. A rescue group had taken in the mixed-breed dog and requested that I evaluate his potential for rehabilitation and rehoming. The dog Otter had gotten himself into trouble by growling at the people who owned him. As Otter climbed out of a big SUV, I could see that he was young, and despite the fact he was wearing a basket muzzle, he hardly looked aggressive. His paws and head were entirely too big for his bony body, and he seemed to have difficulty coordinating all four of his lanky legs. However, when I looked into his eyes, any resemblance to a puppy quickly disappeared. They belonged to a much older soul, one that was not so much angry as it was weary. I knelt in front of Otter, my gaze averted, allowing him to determine whether it was safe to approach me. We stayed motionless for several long minutes. Finally, he took two small steps towards me, lowering his head, resigned to whatever fate awaited him. I didn't want Otter to approach me in fear, so I slowly inched away. Maybe we can get Otter to follow another dog into the building, I suggested to the woman holding the puppy's long leash. I knew from the rescue group's intake form that his owners, an older couple, had used a trainer to help teach Otter his house manners. The trainer had advised the couple to squirt hot sauce in the dog's face when he jumped up to greet them. She had also provided a remote shock collar to be used when he did something they considered inappropriate. So it was clear that Otter was scared to death of people. As we stood in the driveway at Canine Assistance, the nonprofit I founded that provides service dogs to people with disabilities, I knew the only comfort I could offer him was the companionship of another dog. A pretty female golden retriever quickly worked her magic on Otter. He followed her into our office, where he allowed me to unclip his muzzle and leash. The woman from the rescue group said her goodbyes, and without thinking, reached to give Otter a pat. The dog suddenly shied away as if her hand were a hot iron. What on earth will you do with this poor dog? The woman asked me as she turned to leave. We'll start by getting him healthy and showing him he's now safe. If we can, we'll earn his trust and teach him some skills so he can gain a little confidence. As one of my friends says, we have to earn the right to be heard. That poor dog deserves a good life, the woman said. I hope you can give it to him. In 1943, Abraham Maslow, a psychology professor at Brandeis University, published a paper entitled A Theory of Human Motivation, in which he proposed a construct of human needs. Human needs, he believed, evolved sequentially from the most basic to the more advanced, forming a pyramid that culminates in a self-actualized individual when the needs at each successive level have been met. Since its publication, Maslow's hierarchy of needs, as his theory is known, has come under some criticism as, among other things, ethnocentric and exceedingly individualistic. This criticism aside, Maslow's hierarchy provides an excellent basis for describing the needs of dogs and how they rank and structure their most valued necessities. To better describe dogs' needs, I've adapted Maslow's work for my own use and named the pyramid Canine Construction, or C2 for short. The principles are relatively simple. Physical needs, safety, attachment, contentment, all build into a good life. Initially, all efforts will and must be directed to meet the base requirement of canine existence, the first level, physical needs. A dog's primary instincts demand that if he is hungry or thirsty, he focus all his energy on obtaining food and water. Subsequently, if he has no immediate shelter, the dog must concentrate on finding a way to keep his body temperature regulated. Likewise, if he is sick, his illness becomes his singular concern. Fundamentally, a dog must have a healthy body. Only after that has been addressed can the dog turn his full attention towards the next level, safety. This second level of the pyramid is of critical importance in the life of any living being, and certainly dogs are no different. Our dogs have no way of understanding that the yard is safe, but the street is dangerous. Nor do they understand that something isn't safe to swallow simply because they can fit it into their mouths. Dogs, like toddlers, must be protected from the dangers lurking in the outside world. Sometimes they must be protected from even their own instinctive responses to situations, such as the presence of the mail carrier, a running child, or a cat dashing across a busy street. When we help our dogs stay safe and feel safe, we allow them to take that next step on the path to a good life.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.